Nazo hizi mitambo zinakuaga na stori zake. Sara anajaribu kuifinya, nakataa kufinya. I want to ask the worship team if you can come back for a minute. Hamjambo. And good morning. And praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. It's good to see all of you. This is a great day. There is a little chorus that I'll ask them to sing for me. Have you ever tried to remember a song but you can only remember a sentence? Now I can only remember a sentence. I've made you too small. That sentence. You know, but it is a worship chorus. Is it magnified? Oh, something like that. Okay. I'm doing well, eh? The computer is waking up. We want to sing that.
I have made you too small in my eyes, oh Lord, forgive me, and I have believed in a lie that you are
see you the way you are, and we know you
the way you are and who you are.
Yes, Lord.
Minister to us this morning. For this we ask in Jesus' name. And everybody say amen.
Amen.
You stand down with a smile. Blessing the name of the Lord if you can. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you're visiting us for the very first time, please feel welcome. We are glad you chose to come and worship with us. But if we would know where you are, it would make it easy for us to appreciate you. So if you lift up your hand, who spoke to you, we want to welcome you in the house of the Lord. Any visitor that is in the house today for the first time, you have come to our service for the very first time, we want to appreciate you. Amen. Tell your neighbor, again. Now tell them what you mean by again. Tell them. They invited nobody, just tell them. But maybe we invited guys from Celebration and Miracle Service. That's how. So if you are here from Celebration or Miracle Service, let's see you. We want to welcome you too. You are here, you don't come to this service, the Lord bless you. There's one over there. And there's another one over there. Let's welcome at least those ones. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I feel blessed. I feel good, and I'm glad that I'm in the house of the Lord this morning. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 1 to 3. I've entitled what I'm sharing, It's Time to Feel Blessed. Tell your neighbor, it's time to feel blessed. Down to the other one, tell them it's time to feel blessed. Maybe that one doesn't believe in you, turn and look behind you. Tell someone it is time to feel blessed. Maybe have a little fellowship with them and ask them, how are you feeling now? You see, because sometimes you could be seated with someone, you are telling them it's time to feel blessed, and they are wondering, which planet have you come from? But it is time to feel blessed. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the purpose of God, to the saints who are at Ephesus, and those who have faith in Jesus Christ, or Christ Jesus. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us every blessing of the Spirit in heaven, in Christ. We can read with the new Living Translation, which is appearing here. Go to verse number 1. Let's read it together. Let's go back and read it together. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 1, New Living. This letter is from Paul, chosen by the will of God to be an apostle of Christ Jesus. I'm writing to God's holy people in Ephesus who are faithful followers of Jesus Christ. May God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ give you grace and peace. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms, because we are united with Christ. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. Just a couple of things, maybe a few things, just before we dive into this, a few verses about Paul's letter to the Ephesians. If there is a big picture that we can draw from the book of Ephesians that Paul is trying to bring to us, and the verses that we have read, it would be that Paul is trying to tell us this. He wants us to know that if Jesus, the most precious begotten Son of God, was crucified for our sake and for our salvation, something really awesome was at the heart of God's plan for us. And that plan for God was for us to be blessed. Blessed be the name of the Lord. This book was written sometimes around 61 AD or after Christ. And it was written when Paul was in prison. Awesome, isn't it? He is in prison and he's writing these wonderful words to those people that were outside the prison. Have you ever gone to witness to someone and comfort them, and then you have felt a little bit embarrassed?
because of the way they give you real comfort. And you went to comfort them, yeah? Ati wamefiwa. Unaenda unakuta wewe ndio ulifiwa. Because you came so gloomy, like you are someone who is jali, Yesu ametenda, and then they preach to you and comfort you, or you comfortless. And that's what is happening to Paul. Paul is writing to people outside the prison, and he has a word for them. Paul is writing to people that are not in prison themselves, but he has a word for them. So if we are guessing correctly, he is thinking upon the hustling, bustling. He is thinking about the things that we are struggling with. He is not struggling, he is in prison. But he is thinking about the things that we struggle, the things that we are pursuing, the things that we are running after, the things that we are bustling with, the things that we are thinking about. Even some of you looking at me now, you are thinking about it. And your guess could be right. Wealth. He is thinking what people are thinking out there about wealth. And the city of Ephesus was a wealthy city. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. It was a wealthy city. And therefore, he knew what kind of people in Ephesus were thinking. And the same contention about whether or not this letter was for Ephesians church in particular, or for the saints at large, is some people that, like, you know, we normally say when you go to Bible school, what you do is to argue. But when you come to the pulpit, you preach. So we don't want to argue where the letter was written to, but if you go to Bible school, go and argue. Go think about it. Whether it was to the saints, or to the Ephesians themselves, or to everybody, including us. But when you come to the pulpit, preach. And therefore, I'm telling myself, Jimmy, please preach. However, some people think that even if you took it and said, no, this is going to be to the church at Ephesus in the book of Revelation, you're still right. You're not wrong even in that. But what Paul is trying to write to the people is so crucial about the things that we struggle with, the things that we are pursuing. He is in prison. He knows people are thinking about wealth and how to make it and how to get it. And like I told you another day, what is mine is mine, but what is yours is ours. And that is the thought of everybody. What is mine is mine, but what is yours we can share. And many times we want to keep ours so that we can share yours. So if you are traveling together, I want you to pay the bus fare. And so I will sit at the back and allow you to be embarrassed a little in the front. Unalipia wangapi? You know, and you know, some of these makangas are very good. When you give them not kubwa na kuliza unalipia wangapi? And you know, I'm behind them. Till you get embarrassed, you say, hata yule yuko pale kwa kona, namlipia yeye pia. Or even when we go for a meal and we are eating, you know, some of us wait until the bill has come and sat there for a while. We are wondering, si atukue hii bill alipe na hiyo ingine money. You know, that kind of a thing. What is mine is mine. What is yours is ours. So Paul is thinking about what we are. Verse 1 to 3, what we have read. The church in Zimmerman, or the church in Nairobi here, if you like. God has blessed us because we have seen some of the most rich people, very rich, awesome people owning buildings and everything in the city. There are some that are so rich. Yesterday, the ladies and the five men who came to the DOI, bless your heart. Men, you don't know what you missed. I don't want to talk about the ladies, but the you ladies, you missed even double. But men, you also missed. In the issue of conflict management, the speaker gave an illustration that I thought, I don't know what Peterson thought, I don't know what Francis and Kibera, and later on we were joined by Zachary. I don't know what you people thought about the story of this man who thinks because he makes more money than anybody else in his family, he thinks that everything else is rubbish. The wife with a PhD, you look at her, you don't think she either went to Form 4.
amefinywa baka atui amesoma. I refuse kufinywa. But anyway, that's not the point. The point is what he was trying to say, that the people are struggling, that you think some wealth, or because you have made some little money, that you are better off. And I think anybody who struggles with their spouse on who is making more, you are actually would tell you, yo, and I leave you with it. Because how can you struggle with your spouse? At who is earning more, who is earning less, and it is like a fight. Ah, you apana, yo. Duku kama uko hapa, yo okoka. That struggle. Dada kama una struggle, ati sasa, your struggle is so much that your husband, sasa tunamwambia lazima afanye kazi kadha. Ati kwa sababu mshahara wake umeshuka, na wako umepanda. Oh God, have mercy. So anyway, we learned a lot. So Paul here, and our church here in Zimmerman, and in the city, we have known and we know, and God has helped us to see beautiful things on our televisions and the achievements that there is. Not long ago, we saw what Jubilee can do. Did you not see it? In Kasarani, they came and demonstrated might and power. You thought that was enough? Then Johor, the men, demonstrated what the people from the coast can do. And it was not cheap. But every one of them is asking, wewe pesa umetoa wapi? Na wewe mwenyewe pesa umetoa wapi? They are choppers. Wamenunua machopa. I think the next election will be so digital. May God help some of you to find jobs there. And work for only 3 months. Na magari je? Hata mazishi ya Bishop wetu huko Nakuru, because the brother to our bishop was a politician, Honorable Evanson Jam, MP for Nakuru West, which was Molo, 74 to 79. Tuliona hizo za majibiri. Kumbe zile scattered all over. Tuliona moja hiyo ya majibiri huko. So Paul is thinking about that, and Paul is so worried about the struggles that people are struggling with. The second thing that Paul is worried about is people that God has done so much, and they think God has done nothing. That we have allowed our eyes to tell us who God is and what God can do. We have allowed lies to thrive in our hearts so that we don't see what God can do. We think God can only do that to them. We forget what God has done. I have seen some very incredible wealthy people. And I have sat with the people that when you give them 50 million, they tell you this is change. And I wonder, actually, on Monday I was with one of them. And I thought it was very, very interesting. See, I teach a 20 million in Aizam Patia. I teach a million in Aizam Patia. I'm building a church. I'm talking about a million moja, mia tano, mia moja. That's a hisana. Akunipa. So, a few points that I want to bring to you from the passage that we read, verse 1 to 3, that Paul is addressing, so that God can help us. God can help us to understand from where Paul is coming from. Paul, the first point that I want to bring to you, Paul is addressing the obsession with the possession. He's addressing obsession with possession. So the setting of Ephesus is kind of one great big metaphor for us today. Paul wants us to get focused on the subject of our incredible riches in Christ rather than the incredible wealth of our bank accounts and other balance sheets that we have around. Sometimes you look at it and it cannot help you. Oh man, I tell you, one man died. He was a rich man from Makueni. He was a senator. But because he was the sole signatory for his account, people had to do a harambe for him to be buried. So sometimes you have it. The statements are okay, but it cannot help you. But we have some way of that there are not statements, but nobody can take it out of me. And that is what Paul is trying to tell us, obsession with possession. And yet what Paul is trying to push us to is to know that God has blessed us with blessings that cannot be counted. They are awesome in themselves. So I trust you have the picture of the great wealth in your minds by now. The contrast picture of impoverished people walking around, coveting for wealth. You know them. People that are struggling and they are looking. Actually, they are there wondering what will happen. Can they have a meal today? Or what will happen tomorrow? We know that. But we also know, we can picture what it means to be wealthy. I have a friend of mine who travels business class and first class. He normally say, when I grow up, I'll fly first class or business class. But you know the difference, that you people that travel there, you know the difference. Sometimes the difference is, oh, sorry. I know some of you now are saying, Sema, what is the difference? The difference, Nikiti na pombe. So sasa nikienda business class, nikiti itakuwa nikienda. So I ask myself, na nikiuliza kiti kile, unajua kila ndege ina kiti kimoja, para asifue, kuna kiti kimoja, kinakuwa kwa mlango, kinakuwa kikubwa. So unaweza tegea hicho. Na bei saa ingine inakuwa the same, na ikiongezwa itaongezwa kidogo. Do you know sometimes why it becomes very hard to preach something that majority are wondering what you're talking about? I'm sorry. But Paul is so worried. You know, this obsession with wealth that people struggle with. So the first principle that I would like us to deal with today is that spiritual wealth is more important than material wealth. It is not that material wealth is not important to us. It is just not as important as spiritual wealth. Because spiritual wealth, when I die, I will go with it. Amen. But the material wealth, or when I die, I will die. This week we had a wonderful friend from Egypt who came to visit us. And I thought it was very, very interesting. Because there are a few things that I knew about them and a few things that I knew about other places. And Egypt and India had very interesting history. Those long time ago, if your husband happened to be a chief and he died, normally they buried him with all his properties, including the wife. Hata kama ni uko hai na healthy. Healthy. Ziko. I thought it was very funny. Monday, we were discussing Monday with an Indian. He says, you would be taken to the lake with a boat, with all the wealth of that muse, and you, and they burn you. So I do wanna sana kuchoma mtu. Yeah, unachomwa. Can you imagine the pain that you go through? Let's not go there. I can also feel some of you are going there already. Please, let's be here. So the principle is, the wealth that we are talking about, even material wealth is okay, but spiritual wealth goes beyond the material wealth. It does. And I pray that God can help us there. The news is filled with stories of the wealthiest people on earth, and the reality that many of them are unhappy with their lives. This often leads to a destructive path, and often to suicide. Because you become so rich, and then what? Nothing else to do. You know when we were growing up, we knew every boy who had more than one trouser. We knew. We also knew every boy who had only one trouser. We knew. And I'm talking about myself. And I pray, God, give me two. He gave me two. Oh God,
Give me three. He gave me three. Oh, God, give me four. He gave me four. And you know, it is like I thought the more trousers I get, the more happy I will be. Never. It doesn't work that way. Then I thought, suppose I have seven suits so that I can have one suit every day. Will I not be happy? You can't. It doesn't even give you joy at all. Sometimes you wake up in the morning and you are confused. Which one? So rather the way I was before, there was no confusion. It was only one. Naiosha usiku, naipiga pasi asubuhi, haina confusion. Lakini saa hii, wadada bwana asifiwe. Natoa hii unaweka chini, natoa hii unaweka chini, natoa hii. Which one? And you know when you had all the three, no struggle at all. I'm not saying it's bad, but I'm saying the struggle. Na viatu je? Oh God, have mercy. One preacher used to carry a bag, one bag box with shoes. Now you're looking at me like, Bishop, is that true? Actually, we have a friend, myself and Bogo Choroge, who is a professor in one of the colleges in the US. He's a Kenyan, but a smart Kenyan. Tell someone a smart Kenyan. He is so smart and so clean that he has a suit which matches with a shoe and matches with a hat. And they are many. So when he's going to class, he has to look the hat that matches with the suit, and the suit has to match with the shoe. Sasa hizo zingine zinai kusema. So my friend normally tells me, sasa shida kubwa ni asubuhi. Anasumbuka. Because the suit has to match, I don't know, with the weather, with his car. But some of us, ni kaki, ni mfuto ya kaki, na unavaa siku tatu. Wala asifiwe. Na uzuri wa wanaume hawaangaliagi mtu kama wanakuuliza, umevaa tena? But the sisters can do that. Billionaires like Warren Buffett understood this and have purposed to leave their kind, their kids, only a very small portion of their wealth in order not to burden their kids with it. A rich man who decides not to give everything to the kids because it overwhelms them. Now you're looking at me and you're wondering, is that true? Situachiwe. We know the kids of some of the rich people in this country. Imewasaidia. Imewaharibu. Now parents, parasfue. Parents, parasfue. Na mimi ni mmoja wa hao. So in a sense, they know what we know. That for where our treasure is, there our hearts will be. Matthew 6:21 and Luke 12:34. They also know instantly that love of money is the root of all evil. They know that. But Paul is pointing us today to the important truth that our pursuit must be spiritual blessings. And then, a little later on, we will find out that the material blessing will get released after we get the spiritual matters straightened out. Spiritual matters straightened out. Number two, the source of our spiritual wealth. The key portion, or the key text, the key portion of our text today is, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. That is key. The word blessed comes to us from the Greek word elogists, and simply means to speak in praise of someone. In the New Testament, only God is to be blessed in this way. New Testament, worship is initiated by God as to be unto him alone. And the reason, I want to give you the reason. Number one, God is the creator of everything. So he's the only one. Heavenly blessing is God. He's the one who releases them. So creator of everything. A healthy spirituality and theology, a healthy theology begins by recognition of the reality of the book of Genesis, that our God is the creator of all things, both the seen and unseen. God is the Father. God is the author in all the creation. And Jesus was the agent of it. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
So Jesus is the image of that invisible God. He is the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominion or rulers or authority. All things were created through him and for him. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So where does this blessing come from? They come from him. So he is the creator of everything. Number two, God owns everything. Next important thought for us that proceeds from the first one is that God owns everything that he has created. He owns everything. You can look at Psalms 50. It is true that you might have temporary custody and responsibility for the stewardship of a few things, but ultimately, those things belong to God. There is nothing that you have that belongs to you. God owns everything, including you. That's why Paul in prison, he's not moved. He knows he is blessed, even in prison. Why? Because God creates and God owns. You know, can you imagine? He is in prison and he's not disturbed. It's like Joseph. He goes to prison, he becomes busy. And some of you, if you got arrested, oh my goodness, the police do a traffic. Hata kulia utalia machozi. Ukifikiria pale utapeleka. Kwanza ukiingizwa huko na kukua kikiti. Sasa itakuwa ni vita ingine. Na Paul hapo huko. Blessed with the heavenly blessings. Blessed be the name of the Lord. One of the reasons that we have prospered as a church, because we have prospered in a difficult time, because the times are not so good, is because our foundations here are centered spiritually on our responsible stewardship. Because this church is blessed. Talk to the neighbors. They know we are blessed. So when they are selling land to us, they make sure it's expensive. Actually, it's so expensive that nobody else is buying it. So they have to keep on asking you, utanunua, utanunua nini? Because it is, we are rich. But it is only because we pick our stewardship and we are responsible. There is no penny, and that I can tell you, there is no penny that goes to my pocket. I don't. It's good, thank you for your thinking that I carry the offering. But I don't. Come to the third service and you will see there will be other people carrying it. So I don't. Don't wait for Alice. She's not carrying it, you know. We went to a church and it was so amazing, you know. People are giving. That was very interesting. That church must be in Morocco. So here we are. And the pastor's wife is the one receiving the tithe. So the tithe, all the tithe, all the tithe, all the tithe. And then after that he says, now ushers, you can take the offering. Now let me ask you, would that church build anything? Why? Because tithe in the kwaga nyingi. Inaenda na mtu mmoja. Sasa kanisa wataweka mabati, itoboke, waite watu wakuweka ingine, bora asifiwe. But here we are, okay. No wonder we will be moving to the cathedral before you realize it. Hallelujah. So the richer folks around here, they spot us and they think we are wealthy. But the deceives have a wrong ideas. Let's get something straight. The devil doesn't own a single thing. He just convinces the weak-minded that he does. But he doesn't possess you. He doesn't possess your kids. He doesn't possess the generation's future. He owns nothing. He doesn't possess nobody. He doesn't possess the government. And the government doesn't possess us. The government owns nothing. Actually, it is very interesting. Serikali, serikali. And somebody says, I wish I'm not. I don't want even to be a neighbor of that man. Everything serikali, and he owns nothing. Do you know, when the time the Kenyans will know that the government might not help us as much, and the government depends on me and my taxes, then our attitude changes and we start putting tamats all over. Hiyo, watu hawakusikia, lakini
this hour too. Number three, God is all powerful.
It is important for us to accept the reality that God is in charge of his universe. Sovereign over it, he can release blessing and withhold it at will. Now, I know this is the source of a lot of frustration and doubt, but it is nothing the less, or nonetheless, the truth. That he owns everything. He's the one who decides, nitarilizia huyu. I've been reading the Bible, and I have purposed to finish the Bible, reading the Bible twice this year. In the portion that I'm going through right now is God speaking to Moses in the book of Exodus. Actually, I just finished Exodus last night. Moses, God is telling Moses, you know, it is me who decides I will bless who. Now that is key. I am the one who decides I will bless who. And I picked that as my rema word. Because when God says he will bless you, my goodness, he will. But then we have to know. Because people can manipulate us. We have to know that he is all powerful. So just to summarize, it is important that we understand and believe these three statements to be true. Because if we do not, our understanding and view who God is will be inaccurate and there will be so many things in error. Because we will also have an inaccurate theology. If we do not have a right theology of the blessed God, we will approach him in a wrong way and with a self-reliance instead of full reliance on him. We will view possession as our own and not as a stewardship responsibility. We will look at our talents, we will look at our opportunities, we will look at our good ideas as our own instead of originating from God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Can I let you a little secret? Every talent you have and the success you have comes from God. The president of Zambia. Oh my goodness. The president of what? Did he not pray? The security, did they not get confused? May God give us more men that are bold enough, like the president of Zambia. Will Zambia be like Kenya? Never. Will God remember and answer that prayer? I bet he will. I know some of you are saying, "Ariombe wapi? Mutandaoni." So saikine ninaingia huko hata mimi, sio? I'm not so analog in everything. Thank you for those who made sure I got it. Because again, it is some of you that entered before I did. I want to bring this to a conclusion, if I can, in the next couple of minutes. The benefit of being a family. The benefit of being a family. Let's move things along. If our Father in heaven is the creator, the possessor, and the blesser of all things, then maybe there is a family connection that can benefit us. We are not taught to pray anything else, but we are taught to pray our Father. We are children of God. We are children of God. If there is one truth that will help to start and clear the foggy mess of an unhealthy faith today, it is this truth that we are children of God. And John says in John chapter 1, verse 12 and 13, "But to all of you who did not receive him, who believed in his name, to all of you who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of the will of God." We are children of God. To all. And this happens through new birth. This happens through receiving Jesus Christ. Number two, the children of God have family privileges. Tell your neighbor, we have privileges. The son of rider who died, he would drive his vehicle from Karen, and with a strained cap in the front. And there are some friends of mine who said they would wait for him. Wanamsubiri pale kwa maduka Karen. Akichomoka tu, wanamfuata. Kwa sababu magari yao nayo ni meusi. Na mapolisi tu ni kufanya tu hivi kwa sababu huwezi simamisha. Because Castro was not Castro. Castro was Raila. No, you're not getting it. Kenyatta has Jabaind, Jomoind, and Gena. Ushawaona wakiwa peke yao. Security. Security nayo. Hata wakienda shopping. We are children of who? Of God. I want you to, because once you know who you are, even our physical appearance, unapoenda unasemaga wewe ni mtoto ya nani? Ya baba yako. Naona wengine wananiambia wanasema, niseme ni mtoto wake. Basi sema wewe ni mtoto wangu basi. There is that connection. Children of God are family privileges. Let's be quite honest. In the natural, you treat family members differently than outsiders, isn't it? When my kids are growing up, what they ask, I give them. They don't have to be beggars in my house. No, they're not beggars. They have a right. In a healthy way, this principle happens to the church. Sometimes when there is conflict, blood can be thicker than truth and reality, which is unhealthy, because all of us have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus. Sisi sote tuana. Bwana asifiwe. Kwa hivyo hapa, tuombe Bwana atusaidie. Ili tusije tukasema, huyu ni wangu, huyu si wangu. Huyu ni wetu, huyu si wetu. Kwa kanisa. We are children of the Holy God. It is only our children, some of you that is seated here, that you never saw them enjoy wearing your shoe because you bought them shoes. But some of us, when we are growing, oh my goodness, kiatu ya baba, wakati ya yuko, naingia ndani usikie, na ni kubwa usikie tu, kuku. But sasa watoto tunawazaa karibu watoke na kiatu wakitoka maternity, so they don't. But anyway, on a lighter charge. Oh, I would try to wear the one for my father, and man, I tell you, and I will fall many times, but it's like I was praying, God, one day, this I'm wearing, I will wear. Na unavaa unaanguka, you are still walking, you are 2.5 or 3, and unaanguka tu. After 4 and 5, kwani si tulipata kiatu ya kwanza tulizugani? Si tukienda high school, na tulipata kiatu mzuri sana, ili tulisoma miaka 4 nayo. Hiyo kiatu ilikuwa namna gani? Unaenda kwa soko. Na kubuka vizuri pale Thika Market. Unakuta jamaa amekaa pale anakuambia, "Weka mguu hapa." Unaweka mguu. Na uchafu yake anachora. Yaani kiatu hata namba hatukua tukiwekewa namba. Ni kuchora wanachora, wanakuundia kiatu. Kiatu mzuri, miaka ngapi? Kinaingia kwa matope, kinapiga mpira, ngozi sijui ngozi hizo zipo zikitoka wapi? Because some of you know. Mtoto unamrudia kiatu tamu ya kwanza. Na ya pili, kwanza kina katikanga, na ya tatu, yani viatu zikiwa, lakini hiyo yetu ilikuwa hiyo. But I also want sometimes to think, why maybe they did that is because hata miguu yetu ilikuwa tough. Viatu ya But when it comes to blessing, we need our Heavenly Father to be wise on our behalf, which He is. So let's digress for a moment. I want to ask yourself the question, do you believe the things that have been spoken of God this morning? Do you believe that you are His child and you have rights and responsibility in His house? Do you believe that you are rightfully heir to the spiritual blessing that we have discussed so far? Do you concede that God must exercise some restraint in releasing your material blessing to you? Finally, worship should be the natural response to this truth. If all the things said thus far about God are true, the things we need to do is join with the poor in the blessing of God with thanksgiving, praise, and worship. verses 3 to 14. Give us that release. He has chosen you. He has made you holy. He loves you. He has predestined you. He has adopted you. He has graced you. He has redeemed you. He has forgiven you, given you wisdom and insight. He has shared mysteries with you. He has plans for you. He has sealed you with the Holy Spirit. And many, many other things that Paul is talking about, you should release you to worship him. Blessed be the name of the Lord. With all this truth revealed to us, our proper response is to be thankful, is to offer up sacrifices of thanksgiving, to praise him, to worship him, and all this to magnify him and his name forever in our hearts. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Releasing worship. So worship should be the natural response to this truth. Paul is in the prison, but what? Because of that truth, it has released in him worship. He's ready to worship the King of Kings. Laying a hold of the spiritual blessing. I hope you are convinced, because that's what we try to do every Sunday, to convince each other. I hope you are convinced. And I want to leave you with some practical things that will help you lay hold of what already belongs to you. Here is a truthful statement. Faith is the currency of heaven. Tell your neighbor, faith is the currency of heaven. Faith is the only thing that can release the heavenly to you. Remember the song we sang, I have made you too small. Who has made God small? Me. So we are telling God, magnify, let me know him. The creator, the owner, let me know him. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Four things, and I finish. Number one, faith is stirred up by faith. It's my faith that will stir up faith in me. It is my little faith that will stir up faith in me. We have heard the word and we have believed. We have become saints, faithful saints. And because of faith, we become children of God. And heirs to all of the things we have talked about today. Obviously, we find our truth in God's word. Therefore, truth has come and faith has come. Faith is stirred up by truth. So truth that I know stirs up faith within me. That little faith, that little word that I know about God will be stirred up by my faith. That little... Ni ukauka kweli kadogo niko nako kwamba Mungu anaweza. Hiyo ukweli kidogo najua kwamba Bwana atanitendea mema. Hiyo ukweli kidogo ambao naelewa kutoka kwa maandiko ya Mungu, Mungu ananijali. I need to have faith in that. But my faith will only be stirred up by the truth that I know. Secondly, faith begets more faith through worship. Faith inazaa imani nyingine tunapomwabudu Mungu. As we worship, God is magnified. And the bigger he gets in our minds and hearts, the easier it is for us to believe. Oh, yes, again, yesterday, we were here. We saw kitu kazuri sana. Hey, si tuliona kitu, kipeda? Kao kamdudu kanaitwa nini? Ako. Kamilio. Nikaliza dama ni kamilio. Nikinyongo. Mahali kulifika mahali, they were struggling for something. Kulifika mahali tukanona, tukapafa, tukawa tumujitu, toto tuvili. And you know what? The sermon I'm bringing to you, I'm saying this. What can help you is when you make God big. So you magnify God so that you can see God, the creator, the owner of the whole universe. You see God holding your needs in his hands. Make him big. If you are sick, make him the only doctor available. The greatest doctor. Magnify him. Make him the best central bank governor. Hallelujah. Make him big. Make him big. The song we sang, I made you too small in my eyes. Number three, faith activates blessing. Let's see if I'm looking at this the right way. Could it be that if I believe that I will receive mercy, salvation, holiness, power, grace, that these things will come my way? I'm going to be bold and say this is not wholly true. What is true here, and I will borrow from the King James, you, God, have, yes, received. So when I say God has something holding for me and I have received this blessing from God, it's because he's holding it. He is the one who is holding it. And I have to believe it because he has it. God has everything. Blessed be the name of the Lord. God has everything. Finally, faith gets a faith lift through praying in the Spirit. And that's what Paul, later on in this book of Ephesians, wants to give us a climax as we get to Ephesians chapter number 6. The whole idea is, you can feel blessed. And how can you feel blessed? It's when you stir yourself up. I don't know how many of you have come to pray here. Me, I have come here sometimes to pray, and I have felt big. Now that's what I want you to feel in the presence of the Lord, that there is nothing that you cannot do. With God, there is no mountain that you cannot climb. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for speaking to us, that we can feel the blessing. But our feeling of the blessing is when we know you. Dear Father, is when we walk in your counsel. Lord God, is when we desire to see you big in our lives. Open our eyes. Heavenly Father, we want to magnify you in our education. We want you to be big in our finances. We want to magnify you in our health. We want to magnify you in our wealth. We want to magnify you in our situation. We want you to be big. In our domestic situation, we want you to be big. In our families, in the mighty name of Jesus, we want to magnify you. Have you made the Lord too small in your area? And you're saying, yes, you are speaking to me, Bishop, today, and I want to magnify him in my area. If that is the cry of your heart, stand on your feet as we will bring to close our sharing this morning. I want to ask the worship team if they can come and help me again sing that song. And I want you to sing it from your heart as we whisper a prayer that I have made you to sing. It is not them, it is me. It's a confession that we are confessing, that Lord, I have made you to sing.
My
made you too small in our eyes. But Father, we pray that you be magnified in whatever area that we stand this morning in. Be magnified, Heavenly Father. Cause our week, O God, to be a week where we will magnify you in every situation we find ourselves. Blessed be your holy name. We thank you, Lord, and we give you praise. For this we ask in Jesus' name. And everybody say amen. Let's give the Lord some praise in the heart.